amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The Lord has promised good to me, His word, my hope, secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood His mercy reigns, unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow, the sun forbear to shine, but God, who called me here below, will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine. Do you ever find yourself asking God where He's been? Ever get up out of bed saying, I can't do this again? Have you ever been afraid of what tomorrow's gonna bring? And you're facing it alone, at least that's what you think. I can tell you, after going through that valley, even though I couldn't see it at the time, It was in my weakest moments that he held me, and I know you'll find he will carry you when you can't go on. He will be your strength when your strength is gone. He will lift you up. He will be enough to get you through. When the road is long and you want to quit because you think you've got nothing left to give, you can fall apart, fall into his arms. He will carry you. When you get the kind of news that you hoped you'd never hear, when you're chasing down a dream just to watch it disappear, when somebody that you love turns and walks away and they leave you standing there with shattered faith, you don't have to pick up all the broken pieces. You don't have to try and cover up the scars. You are loved and you can always run to Jesus just as you are. He will carry you when you can't go on. He will be your strength when your strength is gone. He will lift you up. He will be enough to get you through. When the road is long and you want to quit because you think you've got nothing left to give, you can fall apart, fall into his arms. He will carry you. His heart is never weary. No, he's never tired. Through the toughest fight, longest night, through the flood and through the fire, he will carry you when you can't go on. He'll be your strength when your strength is gone. He will lift you up. He will be enough to get you through. Fall into his arms. He will carry you. He will carry you.
Psalms 133. As you open your Bible, I was reminded that he was singing that song. He says, when you fall apart, you can fall into his arms. And the book of Job, many of you know where Job comes. The Bible says over and over and over in chapter number 1, the Sabaeans fell. And then it says that God, the things of God begin to fall. It says the Chaldeans made out their bands and they begin to fall. And over and over and over things fell and fell and fell. And I never forget when I wrote down in the margin of my Bible, when everything falls apart, who will you fall on? Amen. Aren't you glad you can trust Jesus? Amen. That song simply said, he is enough. Thank God Jesus is still enough. Psalms chapter number 133 this morning, and that's where we're going to be. I appreciate the Lord, appreciate all that the Lord has done. I want to say this, I'm thankful that y'all let me preach after about 4 weeks of not preaching. I'm glad that you let me take the pulpit back. I was beginning to think y'all didn't want me to, but no, I'm kidding. I do appreciate these men, of course, Brother Brent and Brother Ken, and of course, Brother Jared last week, Brother Michael and them preaching too in that 1 week. But all these men, I'm so thankful that they gave us something from the Lord, not something they just wanted to share, not something that was easy, but they gave us something from the Lord. And I'm glad that preachers still preach the Word of God, led by the Holy Spirit, because when that happens, it can change our lives. Amen? And I'm thankful for that. Psalms 133 this morning, you're going to come to this text. And so we take this. I want you to give me some time. I've been much in prayer, really, about this scripture. It's a number of weeks ago that I began within my own heart to begin to study and begin to ask the Lord a number of questions. And honestly, not just that, but even talking to other preachers, reading different books, listening to different messages, the Lord began to cultivate something within my heart and answer a number of questions for me. I have learned in my life, as we live this life, that there's a lot of questions that we have, and there's a lot of times that you and I will search for answers, but you hear me well, the only answer that ever matters is going to be the answer that we find from the Word of God. If you believe that, say amen. And you say that because what happens is in the darkest, deepest hour of your life, when you are the most lonely, when it has no answer whatsoever, you can't really trust in circumstances, you cannot trust in people, you can't even trust in yourself, because if you listen to yourself, you're going to lie to yourself. But the one thing that you can rest assured upon, it is the Word of God. And I'm thankful that we have a sure word today. Can I get a witness for that? Amen. So as we come here to Psalms 133, you're going to notice in a few moments that it's a very short psalm. Not long at all, but there's a lot of truth that's found in this psalm. You're going to see in a moment when he speaks in context that it is speaking to the brethren. And what that means is it's not the lost folk. It's not the worldly people that's out there that's causing such a ruckus. No, he's talking to the brethren. And you know who that is? That is those of us that are born again believers. Those of us that are sitting here this morning in the house of God, coming today to be able to hear a word for God. So the Lord here begins to speak to us. And I know about how you feel, but I feel the same way, that when the Lord's got something to say, I want to know what the Lord has to say. So you come here and he's speaking about the brethren. Now, I say that because by introduction, to bring something to your attention, I don't know how many of you are raised in a large family. My father, of course, was raised in West Virginia. They had 9 siblings. Most people from West Virginia, for whatever reason, have a lot of brothers and sisters. I don't know how that is, amen. But anyway, I think often about people who have large families. It was later in my years that my aunt began to take me in, and she had an older son and then a younger son, and then myself that moved into the house. And then there was 2 other cousins that were not hers that she began to take in. So we have 5 different, if you could say it this way, almost siblings. And I say that for this reason. If you've ever lived for a certain amount of time with siblings, the greatest thing that matters in the home to most parents is that there's always people that are in one accord, that there's always unity, that everybody has peace when you're sitting in the house. But the one thing that causes the most ruckus is when one argument is to another argument, when one brother is against another brother, when one sister is aggravating a brother, or one brother is aggravating a sister. If you know what I mean this morning, say amen. And so you think about that. Now, I say that for this reason. It grieves the mom and dad because it almost makes you, if I can say it this way, begin to be frustrated. It will make you begin to be disturbed. It does not please you whatsoever. But let me say this. The same way that it displeases a mom and dad is the same way that a lack of unity in a church displeases God. And just like in any home, this is what happens. Well, my brother did it, or it's my sister's fault, or whose fault is it? When the truth be told, it's our fault. It's our responsibility. Everybody must take ownership of what you either did or you did not do, or could be both, that has hindered the harmony and the unity among the family. I want you to notice reading starting in verse number 1. Notice what the Bible says. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. If you're in a habit of circling or underlining words in your Bible, you can underline or circle the word brethren and the word unity, connect them two together. Because here's what he's saying. He's saying that the brethren should be not a question, not an option, not a multiple choice. No, it is expected as a child of God that we are in one accord. That is what it says. And it says not only is it expected, but how pleasant it is. In other words, what joy it is when everybody's in one accord. He goes on down. Notice he begins to break it down. You say, well, what does it look like when there is unity amongst the family of God? He gives us a picture here, starting in verse number 2. The Bible says this: it is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard. It went down to the skirts of his garment, and the dew of Hermon, and the dew of that descended upon the mountains of Zion. For the Lord commanded, for there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. Did you notice in verse number 3?
He says, for there the Lord commanded the blessing. I don't know how many of you would testify to agree with me, but if there's anything that I desire in my life, it is the blessing. I want the blessing of my home. I want the blessing of my marriage. I want the blessing of my relationships. I want the blessing in the church. I don't want there to be friction. I don't want there to be discord. I don't want there to be division, if I can say it that way. If there's anything that I want, I long for the blessing. And I want to say furthermore, as a pastor of this church, and even so much as a member of this church, born again in this church, called to preach in this church, baptized in this church, married in this church, the Lord has done a lot for me just like you. He has for you in this church. As a Bible believer, as trusting in Christ in this church, the one thing that I desire for Haines Baptist Church is that there is the blessing of God among this place. You say, why is that important? Because people still need to hear about Jesus here. The power of God should still be felt here. The presence of God should still be known here. People, when they walk in the door, they should see something different. They should hear something different. They should notice something different. It's not just people that look good, act good, smell good, feel good. No, there should be something here that is real, that is genuine, that is authentic. And we wonder sometimes what hinders the growth of the church. It is friction among the people. There's a number of things you see in this text. You notice, first of all, that as you look here, it is a psalm of unity. Just by way of introduction, you've got to notice that he says in verse number one, he says, behold, he said, how good and how pleasant it is for, notice, the brethren to dwell in unity. Now, wait a minute now. So what that shows us is this, is that it is a psalm of unity. So it's needed that there is unity. But here's what it also tells us, that you can be brethren and not have unity. You say, I don't know about that, preacher. Well, you ask Cain and Abel that. You ask Joseph and all his brothers. You study the scripture where the Bible says in Genesis chapter number 37, that in verse number 3, all of a sudden, Israel, that being Jacob, Joseph's father, he loved him. He loved him. But as sure as somebody loved him in verse number 3, his brethren hated him in verse number 4. So you can be brethren and not have unity. Not only do you notice here that it is a psalm of unity, but also it is a psalm, if you will, notice this, it is a psalm that you see that is of degrees. And what that means is it was a place where they would ascend up as they was beginning to get in the presence of God. If you've ever studied the book of Psalms, you know that they go from one to the next, to the next, to the next. And in Psalms 134, they're at the sanctuary of God. You know what that means? They're in the presence of the Lord. Now, according to my calculations, 133 is before 134. So what does that mean? We are next to last to the closest of God. What's God saying? God's saying the closer to God you get, the more unity there is felt. But I believe there's a flip side of that. That means the closer you get, there must be unity. The further we get must be a lack of unity. So you tell me where we're going. And you tell me why we get there. And you tell me what the hindrance is or what the hindrances have been. And they all always have a name. Sometimes they have a scar. Sometimes it's a memory. Sometimes it's a thought. And we wonder what it is. And we're looking for reasons. And we're looking for answers. And friend, I do the same thing. I have stayed on my knees and over years past and even this year and multiple times, not just in the church, but in families and different situations. I've always wondered, what is it? What is it? What is it? And it seems like the presence of God is just not there. And we're always looking for something to blame. And the truth be told, it's just simply we're not as close to God as we think we are because of the unity. It's just not there. Not only is a psalm of unity, not only is a song of degrees, they're climbing, get closer to the Lord, but also it's a psalm of David. If you notice at the very first of that, you'll see it, Psalm 133, and then right below it, before you get to verse number 1, it says, a song of degrees of David. So that means that David was the writer. Now, we know some things about David. The Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. And you cannot, watch me now, you cannot have the heart of God and not love people the way God loves people. So we see all through this very short psalm, there's a lot of things that are here that is action-packed that we must realize. by the grace of God and by the blessing of God and by the strength of God and with the power of God and with the presence of God, God still and God will and God can do great things in your home and in your marriage, and He can do great things in Haines Baptist Church. But there's one responsibility that we need, is to be able to silence all the murmuring, silence all the whispers, silence all the chatters, and get in one accord and press on for the glory of God. Now I want to ask you something. Are you part of it? And by it, I mean, are you part of the breakdown of the unity, or are you part of the building of unity? You say, well, I ain't really doing nothing. Well, if you ain't doing nothing, you ain't doing nothing. Ha! Somebody say amen. That's deep preaching, ain't it? You know what I'm saying? I mean, I'll be honest with you, friend. I mean, if I played ball all my days. I played baseball, football. I played basketball whenever nobody had anybody else to pick up. But nonetheless, I was on the team. But I'll be honest with you, I can't shoot a basketball. People know it. But you better believe I'm going to be down low, and I'm going to contribute my part for the team. So what I'm saying is, if you're on the team, you need to be doing something. There's a lot of people looking around, and they're searching, and they're seeking answers. But the problem is we're not taking responsibility for ourselves. One man said this: how can we expect Christians to do the big things when they don't do the simple things? What are simple things? Pray. How often do you pray? Read your Bible. I mean, how can we expect somebody to be a super Christian at church when nobody does the simple things? I mean, that's almost impossible. What about serve? Where are you serving? There's nowhere in the scripture says that you were served to be able to do what you do just to go to heaven. No, you were bought with a price. You are not your own. God is now using you. He has a desire for your life. What is you doing? Tithing? What about tithing? I mean, listen, that's part of it. I mean, how can you expect somebody to be able to do the big things when they're not doing the simple things that God asks? What about not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together? Some people want to do big things for God, but they don't even come to church. So with the Bible study this morning, I want to speak on this thought: how pleasant it is. How pleasant it is. I want you to notice a few things that we see here in this text. First of all, you see this morning an Old Testament picture. The Bible says there, notice if you will, in verse number 2, that he comes to this place and he says here in verse number 2, it, what is it? It's unity. It's the brethren that is in unity. So he said it, and then notice those next words, it is like. And then he begins to paint the picture of what it looks like. The first thing he says is it's like precious ointment. Now, if you know anything about the oil that was in those days, it was symbolic of joy. So this is what it's saying, that it's an object lesson, that when you think about the unity among the brethren, there's great joy, there's great joy, there's great joy. And everybody feels it, everybody senses it. They're pressing oil, there's joy everywhere because it's symbolic of that ointment. And the reason it's there is because there is unity and everybody is in one accord. But the problem is that sometimes we don't have the joy we used to have. Maybe it's fair to say that it's because the unity is just not there. So many times people want to be right. There's no joy because it's a battle. There's no joy because there's a struggle. There's no joy because there's something underlining that nobody knows, that maybe you know, and it might not be a church issue, it might be a family issue, it might be a work issue, but there's no joy because there's a breakdown in your life. It is exhausting you, it is depleting you, it is wearing you out completely, but the truth be told, it's because there's just simply no joy in your life. It's a lack of unity. The problem with today, with most Christians and every one of us, we always want to be able to be right. We say that we're right with God, but we're not right with others. Now, you help me preach right there, but I'm telling you, that's the problem. You cannot be right with God and not be right with others. And the longer you put it off is the longer that you ever get your joy back. Do you understand? You can avoid the mountain. You can walk around the mountain. You can try to dig under the mountain. But until you allow God to deplete and remove that mountain, there is no way. You're always going to have that mountain in your life. The walls of Jericho, if you ever study the scripture, the Bible says that the children of Israel, that the Bible says that they had to walk around it. You know what? The Bible says that out of their obedience to what God said, not that it was easy, watch me now, and definitely not that it made sense. Sometimes what God tells you to do to bring the walls down in your life, it never makes sense, and it did not make sense to them. They could have dug under that wall. They could have climbed above the wall. They could have walked away from the wall. They could have avoided the wall. But until they did what God told them to, And some of us have got walls that's in our life, they've been in our life, and they're still erected in our life because we're still refusing to complete what God has told us to do. And we're wondering, what is it? What's different? What's going on? And man, I see it in homes, I see it in marriages, I see it in children, I see it in so many things. And friend, this is not just Haines Baptist Church, but you know as well as I do, ever since COVID of 2020, and I'm not trying to blame COVID, but I have never seen such division. Since I've seen division over masks, vaccinations, that was the president of who voted Trump and Biden. And I understand all these things, and I'm probably down the line with every single one of you. But the problem is because some people got upset or we didn't do a certain thing the way they wanted, it opened up a can of worms. They begin to be verbal about the problems, about the politics. They begin to be verbal about the problems, about the mask. And because of that, it turned around. Well, you know what? The truth be told, I got a problem with you, so now people's got a problem with somebody else, and they got more bold, got more bold than they've ever got, and it has ruined the local church. Somebody asked me a couple weeks ago, been a number of people, of something I might think that's wrong. And I responded to them very quickly, I believe, with all due respect, and I love you, but I believe in today's society that people have lost their respect for the man of God more than I've ever seen it before. It would absolutely floor you. It's a good thing I ain't thin-skinned, friend. It is a good thing. I mean, it's not for the weak. It's not for the faint. And I see people all the time. I was telling a 9:30 crowd this morning, there's only about 5 precious souls that's in there. And it's none of you. And listen, I'm not saying that. But people to this day still think that I was in compliance with the government trying to control us because I allowed a different service for mask-only people. When the truth be told, I've never made you wear a mask. I've never told you how to wear a mask. I never told you not to wear a mask. I've never told you to get a vaccination. I never told you not to get a vaccination. I never told you that coming to church was the right thing to do in a parking lot or coming to the house of God was the right thing to do. I never told you anything about coming back to church on Sunday night was going to affect you, or I've never made you feel bad because people were sick and you just wanted to be careful. I've never done such a thing, but I've never seen people more bold just because they didn't agree. There used to be a time when a preacher could make a decision and people would fall in line. It's just not that way no more. It's just not that way. So you see here, he gives a picture that there is joy. The second thing you see, notice he says that it's not just the ointment, but in verse number 2, he said it went down upon the beard. Notice this, even Aaron's beard. Now we know who Aaron was. He was the high priest. Now who is our high priest? It's the Lord Jesus Christ. But it goes further. It says, his Aaron's beard, and it went down to the skirts of his garment. So this is what it says, that what happens is because that ointment was poured on the high priest, that it was then seen down to the skirts of his garment. So you notice by the skirts of his garment being on the body of Aaron, that oil had been on him. So in other words, those must have been the clothes, and that must have been the body of Aaron. What are you saying, Brother Jason? If Jesus is our high priest and we're walking in unity, then they're going to see by our life and by our testimony, him being our high priest, that we are close to the Lord Jesus the way we're supposed to, simply because we are walking in one accord. Just because you go to church don't mean you're right with God. Just because you sit on the pew and you go to Sunday school, or you don't go to Sunday school, or you sing in a choir, you give a tithe, or you've been here a year or 10 or 100 years, it does not mean we are right with God. If you want people to see Jesus in your life, then you've got to be so close that they realize that everything about you is a reflection of what Jesus would do. He goes a little further. Notice this. As a matter of fact, let me stop here. That oil, listen, that oil, they said that when they had that oil, that what would do is that garment, when it would come on, they would mix different ingredients in it, and they have smells that would come upon it. And so what would happen is it would be those 4 ingredients that would be mixed in, and it'd be mixed with the oil, and it'd be like a fragrance, if I can say it that way. So people knew when you walked by that there was such a smell that said that they knew that you had been with a priest. I was telling everybody earlier in the 9:30 service, I remember when I was a kid, my father, before I moved to my aunt's, my dad was a Rustler blue jean guy. If you know anything about them, they're the most uncomfortable thing that you've ever worn in your life. Somebody say amen. Nobody's ever worn. But nonetheless, it is uncomfortable. But not only that, my father wore Chaps cologne. Now, I remember when I was a kid, my parents separated when I was 7 years of age, and I lived with my father for a number of years. I was very close to my daddy.
And I don't care where I was, what I was doing, if I was wrestling, if I was playing ball, there was something about that strong odor of Chaps cologne that I knew that I was in the presence of my Father. Anybody ever known anybody else like that? Amen. I remember my dad at one time, he used to work at Continental Tires, General Tire, man. He'd come home, smelled just like rubber. I mean, just like rubber. That was my daddy. Amen. I mean, that was my daddy. And what I'm trying to say to you is there's something about our life that when we're in the presence of the Lord the way we're supposed to, and we're surrounded by His love and His mercy and His kindness, and we love the way He loves, people look at us and they know there's something different about our lives. So you see this Old Testament picture, but he gives one more thing because we got to look here. And notice he says, how pleasant it is. You know what that word pleasant means? It means attractive. Do you want Haynes Baptist Church to be a lighthouse in this community? Then do more than open the doors on Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. Do more than have a Sunday school class. Do more than be able to fill the pews whenever somebody says fill the pews. Do more than just simply showing up and having a couple ministries. No, if you want this place to be attractive according to the Word of God, there must be unity in this place. Get rid of everything else if there's not unity. Unity is the number one thing. It's the number one thing. And then he says, notice in verse number 3, what else is it like, David? He says it as the dew. There's something about dew. I don't know if you've ever been hunting or woke up on a good cold morning where it seemed like the dew would shift or it would settle down. You look out there and you begin to see it, and it's something that's almost a wonder, if I can say it that way. If the word I would use, it would be mysterious. You ever look at it and you think, boy, there's something different. You can't explain it. You don't understand it. You say, well, why does that have anything to do about the unity? Because if you've ever been around somebody who has unity, it's something mysterious. There's something distinct about a church that's walking in one accord. You look at them, you say, how could so many people from so many different walks of life, how can they get along? How can they worship together? How can they be in peace with one another? It's not because you pull for the same basketball team. It's not because you work on the same team. It's not because you have the same money in your bank account. That's not the case. The rich, the poor, the popular, the unpopular, those that have everything, those that have absolutely nothing, it makes no difference. The only thing that we have in common, it's a mysterious thing, is the Lord Jesus Christ. But not only is dew something that's mysterious, it's gentle. See, I believe that when we have unity, I believe there's gentleness that's in the house of God. I go back to that lack of respect for different people and also the pastor anymore in churches. I've seen a lot of people, it's like they want to jump in like throwing a rock into the middle of a pond. They're so harsh. They're so big. It's like a splash. They want to make their presence in the choir, and they want to make their presence in a ministry. They want to make their presence in the church. They want to make their presence in a situation. It's almost like they want to draw the line in the sand, whatever they're doing, serving. But according to the Word of God, when there's true unity, everything is a peaceful thing. It's gentle. So not only do you see an Old Testament picture, secondly, I want you to see this. It's a New Testament pattern. Now, this is what's important because we're not living in the Old Testament. We're living in the New Testament. And now we have a local church. You say, well, what does it matter? Well, when you look at this, he gives us a pattern because the truth be told, you and I can talk and we can debate about what matters. What does unity look like? And we can probably both be right, but yet still be wrong. But aren't you glad that the Word of God always makes it plain? So how do you see unity? Is there any example? Well, I think we should start from the first example. Who was the first church and who was the first pastor? It was Jesus. The first church was the 12 disciples. And I don't know if you've ever studied out the 12 disciples, but every one of them were different. You had a tax collector. You have a fisherman. You had some that was spoken, that was outspoken. You had some that would not speak out. I mean, they were from different walks of life. They were from different places. I mean, there were so many different reasons why they should not get along. But do you know how the Lord brought them together? And by the way, you should identify with one of them. There should be something in every one of them that you should say, you know, I'm more like that one, or I'm more like that one, or I'm more like that one. You should probably identify one. I hope it's not Judas. Somebody say amen. But with that being said, the way Jesus brought them all together is simply because in Mark chapter number 3, verse number 14, the Bible says this, that he ordained 12, what, that they be with him. Do you know how he brought them together? It's because they got rid of their old lives, and instead of focusing on the old lives, they started focusing on Jesus. So let's just make it plain. What breaks unity in the church? What is it? I want you to turn over, if you will, to Matthew chapter number 18, verse number 20. want you to give you some Bible examples this morning about what breaks unity in the church. Matthew 18, verse number 20, I want you to notice this. The Bible says this, "For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." And all God's people said, "Amen." But then you come to verse 21. "Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me? For I forgive him till seven times." In other words, he's saying, should I do it seven times? Tell me how many times. "Jesus saith unto him, I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven." You know what Jesus was saying to him? You need to stop keeping count of those people that has offended you. The first thing that will break up unity in the church is unity is broken when people are worried about their offenses. According to the scripture, that was the number one thing. And what Jesus told Peter was this. He says, I want you to understand that it's not about what you deserve. It's not about what you think. Look here, if we all got what we deserved, every single one of us would be in hell. He said, Peter, you got to get over it. And until you get over it, there's not going to be unity. There's not going to be peace. You need to, and I would dare say, Peter probably had somebody in mind. He probably was saying, well, Lord, how many times? Y'all can be quiet, but you might as well tell the truth and shame the devil. You know when you ask questions, it's typically because you got somebody in mind. Can I get a witness right there? Peter's probably thinking about somebody. Somebody probably hurt him, done him wrong, done his family. I don't know. There was somebody, but Jesus says, listen, you got to trust me, Peter. You got to learn, as Brother Mark said this past Monday night, if y'all missed it, you need to go back and listen, watch it. You need to learn to let go of some things. He said on Tuesday night too, so you can reach forward to what God's got for you tomorrow. We're stuck right where we are because we're still holding on to what was yesterday. So the first thing that we see that breaks unity in the New Testament church is people that are so concerned with their offenses. I want you to turn over to Mark chapter number 10, if you will, what the Bible says. Mark chapter number 10, starting reading there if we can in verse number 37. I'm hoping today as a local church that every one of us take this to heart. Because I'm telling you, if there's anything that we need, listen, there's a remnant that God is still using. God has still got big days. This church is not made up of nobody. It's not all about you. It's not all about me. It's not all about the deacons. The only person that matters that shows up every single week is the Lord Jesus Christ. And I don't know how you feel, but listen, these little kids that come up here and get this candy box up under my pulpit, listen, I hope that there's a church 10, 20 years from now, they can still come and hear the gospel. When those kids come out today and get that candy, I hope that there's still a lighthouse here on 4210 Sabrina Lake Road. It matters that we keep unity and harmony in this church. Our generation must do what the previous generation done, because if not, we'll be the ones that will extinguish the church. Mark chapter number 10, notice what the Bible says, verse number 35. It says, "And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, they came unto him, saying, Master, we would that thou shouldest do for us whatsoever that we shall desire. And he said unto them, What would ye that I should do for you? They said unto him, Grant unto us that we may sit, one on the right hand and one on the left, in thy glory." So now you see these two brothers, they're coming to him. This is what they're saying. We want what's best. We want to be able to have it our way. This is what we desire in our life. And this is what happens. When these things happen, it brings friction when all you care about in the church is your preference and your wants. I hate to tell you this, but if it lines up with the Bible, then friend, it's still right. Period. I've had so many debates, so many questions about things and thoughts and changes and whatever. There's never, ever a time of a change. Never a time. But when you begin to be on your hobby horse about what you want, you're the one that's hindering the unity. Brother Jason, I don't believe that. Use the Bible. Read verse 41. Put it up there. Notice what the Bible says in verse 41. He gets it up there. I'm going to read it. You find it? Watch this now. "And when the 10 heard, they begin to be," what now? "Much," what's that next word? "Displeased." You say, why was everybody mad?
Why was everybody upset? Why was there such friction? It's because there was two people. Watch me. Not even the majority of the church. There was two people that were so bent on having what they wanted that they stirred a ruckus up and it displeased everybody else. I wonder how many of y'all don't like something and begin to sow discord. Sows division. Because something's not the way you want it. It's not done the way you want it. But yet we want liberty. We want to fill the altars. We want people saved. We want people to be born again. We want homes to be fixed and marriages to be brought back together. We want all of these things. We want the power of God. And you got to quit always being upset because you don't get what you want. Can I tell you something? No disrespect to all of our Sunday school teachers, but I don't care to have all those Sunday school classes because all of them ain't for me. Amen. I don't care that we have a choir. I'm glad I get to sing in a choir. I'm thankful I just get to get up there and sing. Listen, there's songs that mean a lot to me because it reminds me of a certain place, of a certain time with the Lord done. And there's some songs that don't mean a lot to me, but it's not because I don't like it. It's not because it's not biblical. It's because there's just nothing personal for it. But at the end of the day, as long as it's helping somebody else, it's not all about Jason Holly. And it's not all about you. And I don't care if you've been a member for 5 days, 5 years, 50 years, or 100 years. Nobody is more important than nobody else. Period. So you cannot always get what you want. So you say, what breaks the unity? What is it that makes the struggle? Well, the first thing is that we're so worried about our offenses. The second thing is because we so focused on what I want. And the third thing, watch this now. Let's turn over to John 21. John 21. The Bible says in John 21, starting in verse number 19, it says, this spake he, signifying by what death he should glorify God. And when he had spoken this, he saith unto him, follow me. And then I want you to notice this. Here's old Peter again. Then Peter, turning about, watch this now, seeth the disciple whom Jesus loved following, which also leaned on the breast at supper and said, Lord, which is he that betrayeth thee? I mean, listen, all John was trying to do was get close to Jesus. That's all he was doing. But watch Peter's response. Verse number 21. Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, said, Lord, and what shall this man do? In other words, he was so worried about what John was doing, and he was literally distracted by it. Do you know why unity is broken in a local church sometimes? Because we're more worried about what everybody else is doing instead of what we're doing. If you would take care of your own home, your own family, and get it in one accord, then we might have one accord at church. Amen. I mean, I'm telling you, I mean, we have a responsibility. And sometimes we don't realize it, but there's usually a common denominator, and I can see it, friend. If there's a certain group that begins to have issues or a certain group that begins to do this or a certain family, then there's usually a common denominator. There's something that just ain't right, but it ain't the Lord. So you come to this text and this is what you see. What is it that breaks the unity? Holding on to offenses. Always wanting it your way. Or always worried about what somebody else is doing. I want to switch over real quick. If you're right there at John 21, but I want you to notice this, and I'll move to my last point. Go to Acts chapter number 1. All you can do is just turn over the page right there. I want you to notice in verse number 12, we'll skip down a few verses. Let's just go verse 12, and then we'll skip to verse 14. Then returned they into Jerusalem, talking about all the disciples, from the mount called Olivet, which is from Jerusalem, a Sabbath day's journey. Verse number 14. These all continued with, what's those next words? What's those next words? One accord. I want you to go down to chapter 2. Same page. I want you to notice what the Bible says in verses 1 and 2. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with, what's those next two words? One accord. In one place.
And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house wherewith they were sitting. So now you see, these men are now back in one accord. Now I want you to go down to verse number 46, same chapter. Verse 46, same chapter. The Bible says this, and they continuing daily with, what's those text two words? Everybody say one accord. You say, Brother Jason, look at me for a second. Let me be a teacher and not just a preacher. You tell me the difference in these 12 men, these 11 men, from Matthew, Mark, and John to where we are in the book of Acts. You want to know what's the difference? Since then, they've seen the Lord die. They've seen him on the cross. They watched how he suffered. They've seen the price that was paid for them in spite of who they really were. And what happened is somewhere in that journey, when they took their eyes off of their offenses, their wants, and what everybody else was doing, they set their eyes on Christ. And you know what happened? It brought them all in one accord. I can't give you an answer for everything, but I can tell you the answer that God gives. I can't explain why things happen, but I can tell you what the scripture says to get to where he wants us to be. And that's to set our eyes on the cross and remember what he's done for you. And as God has treated you, loved you, forgave you, had mercy and grace upon you, kindness, loved you when you were unlovable, you too should love others the same. The Bible says that by this they shall know that you are my disciples if you love one another. The Bible says this, blessed are the peacemakers. Can I ask you something? Are you making peace? Because the Bible says that blessed are the peacemakers, not the peacekeepers. Show me the person show me the person standing in the gap. You know why we're having a Bible study for men? Because I'm looking for some men that says, you know what? I don't care what the world does, because the devil's going to fight, friend. It's not going to get easier. It's not going to get easier. It's going to get harder. You think right now we're scratching our heads like, how in the world did we get here? Friend, you just wait till a couple years from now. And I don't care if you voted for Biden or not Biden. I mean, it makes no difference to me. But at the end of the day, we don't know who the next president is. When are you going to do it? Everything's stripped away. I mean, all of a sudden something else comes alive. I mean, people are going to be so dysfunctional, so mad. And if our eyes are not set on Jesus, just like a lot of unchurches, unfortunately, this church, too, might be an example of a lack of unity. As I get somebody to come to the piano, I'll give you this last thing. Not only do you see an Old Testament picture and a New Testament pattern, but I want you to see this. There is an eternal principle. Turn over to Ephesians chapter number 4, if you will. Ephesians chapter number 4. What is that eternal principle? Well, it's very simple. Our God is a God of oneness. I want you to listen to what the Bible says starting in verse number 1. I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, listen, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called. Notice these words. With all lowliness and meekness. Let me stop there. Can that be said about you? Can the people closest to you who know you, can that be said about you? Notice the next word, with long suffering. Can that be said about you? Are you long suffering? Let's keep going. Forbearing one another in love. Can that be said about you? When's the last time you told a brother or sister in Christ, I just love you? You said, well, I want unity. Well, let me just ask you this question. If you're married today, how well is your marriage if you don't tell your spouse you love them and spend time with them? This is a family. This is a family. The Bible says this, verse number 3, endeavoring to keep, watch this now, the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Go to verse number 13. Till we all come in the unity of the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God, unto the perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. You say, well, what is it, Brother Jason? I want you to go back to verse number 4. Notice the word one over and over and over. There is one body and one spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. But unto every one of us is given grace according to the measure of the gift of Christ. You know what the eternal principle is? The same God that's always blessed churches and people in the past is the same God that will do it today, but it starts with a oneness. You know, listen, and I'm done. It's 12 o'clock. Listen to me. I have seen terrible ball teams win games and overcome great opposition, not because they had all the talent, but because they played together. They believed in one another. Watch me now. Look, and I love y'all, but I'm going back to my first days of being saved. When I first got saved and got born again, even though I stumbled and even though I staggered, you know what helped me keep pressing on? It wasn't the fact that God called me to preach, because God hadn't called me to preach. It wasn't the fact that I knew I would pastor Haines Baptist Church one day, because that was the last thing that was in my mind. But it was men and women, but specifically men in this church, that no matter what I did, no matter what I went through, they loved me with an unconditional love. And can I say it this way? Look up here for a minute. The weakest person that's in the church was the weakness of everybody else in the church. There was no such thing as, oh, well, they're just weak. No, if they're weak, I'm weak with them. If they're burdened, I'm burdened with them. You understand? It's part of an ownership. Daniel, I love you. I'm going to use you for a minute. I walked by Daniel on Monday. I guess it was Monday. It might have been Sunday. I don't know. And I noticed his countenance was a little different. He's a big boy. He's bigger than I am. Amen. But I had to lean over there. He's sitting down. I said, I want you to know I love you. Now listen, the Lord just told me to do that, but I didn't know what it was. But that's part of it. There's people that's in this church that they need to know that no matter where they are, you love them. That you care about them. And yes, they're going to make mistakes. And yes, they're going to do things. And I'm not saying we condone that stuff, but I'm telling you there needs to be a oneness where we're not so worried about people who didn't do it our way and they offended us or made us mad. At the end of the day, there's never going to be unity as long as you're holding on to that. Truth be told, there won't be unity, but there will be a root of bitterness. And every root always brings fruit. You got to get over the fact that you don't always get what you want. I don't always get what I want. Amen. I don't. You got to get over the fact that so-and-so done this and so-and-so done that. Man, just let it go. Yesterday, my son was playing ball and for some reason, they had a big band competition that was behind them. So the whole time when they're out there playing ball, you hear I mean, it's like felt like I was in a college football game sitting at a baseball game. Amen. But you know, all those instruments, that word run a chord, do you know what that is? That's a musical word. And what that means, it means being together and making progress. So when you get up there and you see all those instruments, I don't know how you are, but I'm not very talented at doing those. But you get the flute playing one thing and the drums playing something else, and you get the baritone playing this, and you get the tuba playing this, and you get the trumpet playing this. And if they're playing on their own time. You know, they might be playing what they want to play, but they don't ever sound good. But you know what happens when that conductor gets up there? And he taps that. And they're all following that one person that's in charge. You know what happens? You remember that word pleasant I said? It's attractive. That music begins to be attractive. And you know what we need to do? We need to look unto Jesus. We need to look under the leadership. And I'm not tooting my own horn, but I'm preaching the Bible to you. We got to follow the Lord. And listen, some of us think that we're the watchdogs. According to the scripture, there's only one shepherd. I'm just being honest with you. And we're so busy trying to do everything else that we're weakening ourselves. So by invitation today, and listen, I'm preaching to the church. And I know I am. I wonder how many of us would say, you know what? I don't know how to play the tuba. I don't know how to play them drums. And I can't play that baritone, but I know I can play what I got. And Lord, if you'll get up there and you'll lead us, I'll quit worrying about what everybody else is doing. And I'll do my part. Now let me say this to you. I love you, but I'm not interested in you coming down here and just making a little prayer and not sticking to it, because the devil won't be happy. If you're serious about letting God use you, then you be serious about doing business with the Lord. But don't come down here, because here's what happens. If you can't do it, friend, listen, be honest. Say, God, I need you to strengthen me. Because we need to be so much in one accord that we love those that are weak and we love those that are strong. And we realize that we're not going to press on without sticking together and looking unto the Lord together. Heads bowed, eyes closed, you standing feet.
It is a joy and a privilege to be able to know that you've tuned in. And I pray that today that the word of God that was shared will be a blessing to you. If somehow, some way that the Lord has spoke to your heart, and maybe you're sitting where you are and you don't know for sure that you're saved by the grace of God, and you've ever trusted Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, then I want you to know that the word of God says that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible makes it very plain, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. You say, how do I get saved? You have to trust in Christ and Christ alone. Repent of your sin, and then know, as the Bible says, where Jesus says, I am the way. And I pray that today that will be your desire to be able to seek out for the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to trust Him as a Lord and Savior. If you do that today, and you repent of your sins, and you take Him as your Savior, would you do us a favor and contact our church office at 336-788-0551? We would love to be able to speak with you. We would love to be able to encourage you, maybe be able to help you find a local church, no matter where you are today, and maybe even possibly disciple you. So we want to say thank you so much, and we are definitely going to be praying for you and this ministry that our church has. If you know you're saved and maybe the Lord spoke to you in a different way and there's something heavy on your heart, again, that same number, if you can contact us, we'll be so thankful to be able to reach out, be able to speak with you. But again, on behalf of the church and myself, thank you so much, and may God bless you.